You're listening to the audio production of Intimacy with God, Cultivating a Life of Deep Friendship Through Obedience, by Randy Clark, published by Thomas Nelson, and read by Milton Bagby. Dedication. First, I dedicate this book to my wife and daughter, who have lived a life of intimacy with Jesus. My wife, Deanne, is such an inspiration to me. Her prayers of intercession in times of crisis are answered so frequently, so quickly, it is amazing. I tell her she is God's pet. Our daughter Johanna was hearing from God when she was only 3 years of age and spoke words that were so important to her mother. Later, God was speaking to Johanna as a young teen before he spoke to me about moving our family halfway across America. Second, I dedicate this book to the rest of my family, my three sons, Joshua, Josiah, and Jeremiah, my son-in-law David, my daughters-in-law, Tanya, Allie, and Lizzie, and my grandchildren, Simeon, Selah, Malachi, Harper, Juliet, William, Nova, Ember, and Ronan. Third, I dedicate this book to my spiritual children, associate ministers Charity, William, and Brian, the 57 others who were interns or traveling partners with me over the past 26 years, and my students of the Global Awakening Theological Seminary, Global Awakening College of Ministry, and the Global School of Supernatural Ministry. I want to acknowledge the following students whose testimonies appear in this book: Brian, Kaisa, Matt, Jessica, Caleb, David, Will, and Benjamin. I am proud of them for stepping out in faith to minister to others. Their stories are only a small sample of the many testimonies from students in the school's physical healing course. It is my hope that I have modeled before you a passion for the kingdom of God, love for the Savior, and compassion for people. I want to encourage all of you to be all you can be in His kingdom, to pursue intimacy, obedience, revelation, faith, and signs and wonders for His glory. Foreword. I am the last person I would ever have expected to be asked to write a foreword to Randy Clark's latest book. I am not a world-class evangelist, or a learned scholar, or a famed expert on the gifts of the Spirit as Randy is. All I am is a seeker of truth. I have been so since I became a believer in Jesus, Yeshua, my Savior, as a young 12-year-old girl with big dreams sitting in a darkened movie theater in Annapolis, Maryland. I believe Almighty God, divinity, meets all needy people like you and me, humanity, right where our hearts and our dreams live and breathe. I had wanted to be an actress and a singer since I made my debut fresh from my mother's womb. The God who created me in that very womb and placed those very dreams inside my heart in that dark and secret and sacred place had a plan for me even then. By the closing credits of the film I had watched, The Restless Ones, I had a choice to make. Would I follow the way of the world, or would I choose to follow the way himself? I had grown up in a loving home with a Jewish father and a Gentile mother. We were not a religious church-going family, but I was taught that God was real. That evening, so many years ago, in that dilapidated little movie theater, still a child in many ways, I heard a voice. I knew it was Jesus. It wasn't audible, but it cut to the very core of my soul as if it was a symphony. "Kathie," he said, "I love you, and if you'll trust me, I'll make something beautiful out of your life." I literally ran down that aisle to receive that promise and sign the covenant. He who promised me has been faithful. I look back at that moment as the singular most significant decision I have ever made. I now have a lifetime of experience with this Savior, Friend, Redeemer, Lover of my soul. I can proclaim His glory to the nations and the heavens beyond, because the God I was told was real has proven He is real every day of my existence. I have seen miracles in other people's lives. I have experienced many miracles in my own. I have encountered demons, and I have watched them flee when they were commanded to leave in the name of Jesus. The gifts of the Spirit described in the Bible, 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verses 8 through 10, are every bit as alive and powerful today as they were in the days of Jesus. Jesus Himself promised in John chapter 14, verse 12, "Truly, truly, I tell you, whoever believes in me will do the works I have been doing, and they will do even greater things than these, because I am going to the Father." He sent His Holy Spirit to all who believe in Him, that we might continue His good work in us, to heal a hurting, rotting, broken, and hopeless world, full of people who need Him. To deny that the gifts of the Spirit are still real and available today is to deny the very promise of the one we say we believe in. And thus, we choose a life in the shadows of the truth instead of the full light and radiance and power of the Son Himself. "Fear not" is the most frequently mentioned commandment in all of Scripture. Randy Clark is a man who has lived out his life of faith fearlessly and has passed on this living truth to anyone who had ears to hear and hearts to believe. I pray that as you read Intimacy with God, you too will lay down all fear and step out in faith, believing to walk on the water with Jesus. You too will move mountains. You too will do miracles. For in the name of Jesus, you can do all things. Kathie Lee Gifford. Introduction. It is exciting to realize that God communicates with us, especially when that communication takes you into an experience of the power of God that touches the life of another person in a profound and beneficial way. The person may benefit in a number of different ways by the information God gives you to share with them. Sometimes this information results in healing. This healing can be physical or emotional. It can come in the form of deliverance from addictions or demons or both. God might bring provision, either supernatural or natural, and reconciliation between friends or family or with God. But how does this happen? And what are some of the ways in which God communicates with us? I see it happen through faith. Faith created as God's Holy Spirit conveys information to individuals who have learned how to recognize these communications as coming from God. You may be asking, so how exactly does this kind of communication work? We know that God communicates with us through His Son Jesus and through His written living word, the Bible. I have often heard people say, the words of Scripture seemed to jump off the page. When God highlights a portion of Scripture that He wants to use in the moment to bring our attention to a specific need or to give direction for a current situation, charismatics call it a rhema word. A rhema word is a word from heaven through an individual about something they are to do, which carries with it the power of God to bring the word given into reality. Rhema is also often the means used by God to build or create a gift of faith or a major increase in faith for ministry related to the rhema. Rhema words do not contribute to new doctrine or scripture, but to issues of life where direction, help, or encouragement is needed. Similarly, God sometimes gives us words of knowledge, which are His instructions for what He wants to do. The gift of words of knowledge or prophecy don't add any new truth to our faith, but are ways God provides us with new information that encourages our faith. God also communicates through dreams, open visions, impressions, mental pictures, feeling pain that is not your pain, and even seeing words that supernaturally appear in your mind's eye. God often communicates through divine appointments that are not mere coincidences, but are orchestrated by the Holy Spirit. When I speak of communication through faith, I am referring to faith in two different ways. The first refers to the core beliefs we have about God, the Christian faith, and its doctrines, and it is related to truth, the truth made known to us in the Bible. The second refers to the faith to trust or believe so strongly that one actually acts on the first kind of faith. It is possible to obtain new information from God about practical, specific things in life, information He is giving to us for a purpose. This type of communication from God is not the same as the truth that comes from the Bible. No new truth can be added to our canon. This is an important distinction to keep in mind as you read this book and the testimonies I am going to share with you. The Bible itself, however, presents narrative accounts of people who were receiving communication, revelation, that was true communication from God and true revelation, but the Bible did not include what the revelation was or what the words were. Other prophets and their ministries are mentioned, but the quality of the revelation, the nature of it, was not such that it merited being included in the canon. A concise way of saying this is that the Bible indicates there was special revelation that became part of the canon, and there was also specific revelation that was not deemed to be included in the canon. These testimonies illustrate ordinary people receiving communication from God that He intends to use to touch lives profoundly and beneficially. They are drawn from the experiences of my interns and associates, students in my seminary class on physical healing, as well as lay people who work in diverse fields, such as banking, marketing, farming, and in the home. Additionally, you will find testimonies from pastors, including mainline denomination pastors, itinerant pastors from around the world, and missionaries. For my seminary students, part of their coursework is to have at least one experience every week for 6 weeks, where they receive a communication from God, either in the form of a word of knowledge or prophecy that provides opportunity for them to pray for someone in need of healing, deliverance, or salvation. The general age range of these students is early 20s through 40s. Although a few are older, their testimonies give witness to how followers of Jesus today can live the intimate, supernatural life He intends for us to live in the power of His Spirit. This book is not focused on theology alone, or solely on discussing scriptural interpretations that are important but can be debated. It is my desire that you see and understand what God is doing in the world today. Many people find God's miracles hard to believe, and therefore distrust what they are hearing. Jesus says that we are to judge the false prophets by their fruit. In other words, when you look at the results of the miraculous, do you see the fruit of God as found in Scripture, or something else, the rotten fruit of the devil, or the ability of the human spirit and not the Holy Spirit of God? The testimonies you are about to read are stories of the fruit of God and clearly illustrate the fruit of communication from God to believers today. The testimonies from students in my seminary class are very recent, from the past 6 weeks as of this writing. The students shared many more case studies than those I have used in the book. 30 students submitted 180 case studies. As you read through these testimonies, I believe you will agree that they profoundly illustrate communications between the Good Shepherd and His sheep. Jesus said, "My sheep hear My voice." John chapter 10, verse 27. I want to begin with a testimony from Brian Starley, an associate minister on my staff. Brian went to the Global School of Supernatural Ministry for 2 years.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.